Thank you for watching Truth and Justice with Vivian King. We have a great show planned for you tonight. We have in the studio Mr. Mark Simien, and he's going to tell us a story of being on death row. He was actually on death row in the 70s, in 1975, in Louisiana, and he lived through that experience. He got his case overturned by the United States Supreme Court. We're excited to hear his story, and I'm excited as a lawyer to educate you about the criminal justice system as it relates to murder and death row cases. We also have in the studio Ms. Tina Watson, a very well-known and well-respected criminal defense lawyer in Fort Bend County. And I have my very good friend and church member, Mr. Danny Sneed, the encourager, who works with the prison ministry and has been to prison. And he works with our prison ministry at St. John's United Methodist Church downtown. So let's jump right into it. Mr. Simien, thank you so much for agreeing to tell your story, to enlighten us and educate us about the criminal justice system and the experience that you had. So it's my understanding that Mr. Simien got in trouble when he was 15 years old. So just tell us a little bit about your childhood and what led you to being 15 and facing death row.
Well, my childhood was kind of strange because my mom and dad split up, and I was staying with my grandmother till I was 7 years old in Louisiana in Lake Charles. And then when my grandmother died, my dad came and picked me up and took me with him to Homer, Louisiana, in Claiborne Parish, up by Shreveport and Bossier City. And me and my father, I was staying with my stepmother and my dad, but the thing about it is that I was always treated differently, you know, by my stepmother. And it kind of triggered me to do a lot of stuff that, you know, that would be, you know, perwiskin, you know, things that I would do would make her mad, and she, you know, she would whip me and, you know, do
things. But not her other children.
Yeah, not her other children, but I would always get the worst end of everything, and my dad would, you know, he would go along with what she say, so. And then I just started doing stuff just to, you know, what a normal kid would do when they wasn't getting the attention that was normal. You know, I started stealing little things and breaking in schools, and, you know, and I started robbing people, you know, at a young age, you know, and but the thing about it is that, you know, I was getting away with a lot of things I was doing, you know, and then all of a sudden I started graduating to the bigger things. I started selling weed, I started popping pills, start smoking the weed I was selling, and I started doing things that were, you know, that were grown-up things that at a young age. And the next thing I know, a guy told me, he said, well, you know, we need to start stealing cars. We started stealing cars, we go up to a lot, car lot, steal the cars, and then we upgraded and start stealing cars and driving dope across the county. And then we got the nickname the Cartels Kids. So, but one day we were in the courtyard, and this guy walked up to us, and he had a sawed-off shotgun. And he said, give me all your money and all your drugs. Not knowing that it was three of us, one guy was behind him. And he was 16 years old, and he shot him in the head, point blank.
So the guy that came up to jack you and your friend shot your friend?
No, the guy that was with us shot him. Okay. Walked up behind him when he seen him with the shotgun. Okay. He heard what he said and walked up behind him and shot him point blank in the back of his head. Okay. And when he shot him in the back of his head, the first thing we did was look around to see if anybody was looking. We didn't see anyone, but somebody did see us. Mm-hmm. And we tried to hide the body. We put the body in the car to try to hide it. And we took it and dumped it in a nearby ditch. But somebody saw everything that we did.
But did they also see that the man had a sawed-off shotgun?
Well, the witnesses that came to court did not say anything like that. They didn't say that they saw him with a gun or anything.
But did he have the gun?
They found the gun.
Did the man have the sawed-off shotgun?
Not when they found the body.
No, but I'm just saying, but the man that said, give me your money and your drugs, that was the 35-year-old man.
Yes, and he did have a sawed-off shotgun.
And when y'all disposed of the body, what did you do with the sawed-off shotgun?
We threw it in the lake.
Okay.
We threw it in the lake because we were actually, I mean, you know, 15, 16, 17 year old, we feel we could get away with this. You know, because, you know, I mean, we watching TV and different things that happen on TV. We figure if they can get away with it, we can too. We can dispose of a body too, you know.
But so where'd y'all put the body, in the lake too?
No, we dumped it in a nearby canal. It was a canal nearby that we dumped it in and throw trash and leaves and everything on, not knowing that somebody was watching everything we done.
Wow.
So we.
And at that time, what age were you?
I was 15.
And the trigger man was 16?
16, and the older guy was 17.
Okay. So who did the 35-year-old man come up to and say, give me your money and your drugs?
He came up to me and the 16-year-old.
Okay.
Because we were counting the money that we had made.
So y'all were counting the money out in the open?
Yes, and we was in the park, and we was on a bench. And we had the cars parked around the bench with the doors open.
Okay.
Well, we were bagging drugs.
Okay.
But, you know, we were selling black mollies and all kind of drugs we were selling, you know, out of the trunk of the car. But when he walked up to us and told us that he wanted to, you know, that he wanted all our drugs and money, the first thing we did was we were fixing to give it to him until the 17-year-old walked behind him. And shot him in the back of his head. When he shot him in the back of his head, we didn't even hesitate because we were high. We were on drugs.
Okay.
You know, and we laughed about it.
Wow.
You know, we laughed about it, and, you know, and went and tried to hide the body.
And the man you shot was white?
He was a white man.
And the three of you guys were black?
We were black.
Okay. Now, were you still going to high school, or had y'all quit school?
We were shooting hooky. You know, like, I mean, we'd go when we feel like going, and when we didn't want to go, we didn't go. Because during that particular time, I left home. I quit going, I mean, but I was staying with an older woman.
Oh, my God, and you were 15?
I was 15.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you were living with a woman older. How old was she, 20?
No, I think she was about, I think 30.
Oh, my God, you were really grown.
Yeah.
All right, so the man that tried to jack you was a 35-year-old white man. Y'all disposed of his body in the canal, threw leaves over it, threw the gun in the lake, a separate lake. And then what happened after that? You're high.
You're
laughing because you got away with it.
We thought we got away with it, but we really didn't, because the next day, the whole police force came where I was at to get me. And when they came to get me, I said to the people that was in the house with me that I'm not going alive.
Oh, Lord.
And so I grabbed a rifle, automatic rifle, and two pistols with shoulder holsters and put them on me. And when I was going out the back door, that's when one of the officers threw me down and put a shotgun to my head and told me don't move.
Wow.
Other than that, I think I would have probably, you know, would have had a shootout with the police.
Oh, you were that crazy?
Yeah. And I was on drugs. I was full of drugs.
What kind of drugs were you taking?
I was taking black mollies, red devils. I was smoking weed. You know, I didn't drink because I couldn't drink. I didn't know how to do that. Mm-hmm. But the thing is that I felt like when I was high, I could do anything. You know, that was my state of mind. I felt like, you know, nobody could do nothing to me as long as I was high.
Wow.
You know, and I felt like that I could really shoot them and get away.
Oh, wow.
That's how I felt at that time.
Wow.
But God wouldn't allow it to happen that way.
Wow.
As soon as I went out the back door, that's when the cop threw me down.
Wow.
And put the shotgun to my head and told me don't move.
Wow. And from there, where'd you go?
Straight to jail. They took me to jail. They put me in jail. They put a $70,000 bond on me.
And this is 1975.
1975.
With the father and stepmother, so you know they weren't gonna try to make your bond.
Now my dad, he came to see me, and he told me you did the crime, do the time. And that was the last I saw of him. After that, my stepmother, she never came to see me. So.
Did you have a mother still alive at the time?
Yeah, my mother was in Louisiana. Mm-hmm. But my mother, you know, I mean, she wrote me a couple of times when I was locked up, but as far as coming to see me, never.
Never. So when did the other two boys get arrested?
They got arrested, I think, a month after me.
Did you tell it on
them? No, they were running.
Okay.
They were running, I think family members told on them. Because they were trying to get it out of me, and I wouldn't tell it.
Were they beating you up, or?
Well, they was, you know how they talk crazy to you.
Now, were you in the juvenile facility, or were you in the adult facility?
No, I was in the adult facility.
You never went to a juvenile facility?
Never went to a juvenile facility.
Even though it was 1975, and you were 15 years old?
Yeah, they did not, you know, the cops.
You were grown men, in jail with grown men.
In jail with grown men, but we had separate cells. Separate cells.
So back then it was one person to a cell.
It had separate cells. It was a new jail they had just built, what they put us in. And it was, I mean, we only come out for a shower and go back in. But there were steel doors, and they kept us in there.
Wow. At 15, how did your mind contemplate that existence?
Well, after I was sober from being high, it kind of hit me. Mm-hmm. And I realized, and when I went out to take a shower, the jailer said, well, this is a jail that nobody can break out of. Well, he shouldn't have told that to me.
Oh, Lord.
Because I took the shower door off.
Oh, my God.
And knocked the window out and got out.
You ran away?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. And then what happened?
Well, they eventually caught me because I went to that lady house I told you I was staying.
Because you're stupid and you're 15.
Yeah.
And so you go right back to where they arrested you.
And they made sure that the next time they put me in jail that they cuffed my leg to the bed.
Oh, God. How long did you stay cuffed to a bed?
For about 3 months.
What?
They give me a shower and cuffed me back to the bed.
Oh, my God.
Wow. Oh, wow. That's an awful existence.
Yeah.
How did you make it, sweetheart?
Well, the thing is that, a doctor came in and he made them uncuff me because it had messed my leg up because I was really trying to get out of it.
Mm.
Every chance I got, I was
trying to squeeze your foot out of it.
Trying to get my foot out of it, and I was scarring my foot up.
Oh, my goodness. And so they finally, someone was humane enough to bring a doctor in to at least look at your leg.
Yeah, because the thing about it was getting pretty bad.
It was really infected.
One of the jailers saw it, and he said, we need to get somebody in here. Because at first they had bandaged it up. And when I took it off to take a shower, he looked at it, and he said, it's real bad. We need to get a doctor to look at you. And that's when the doctor told me, you need to take this off. This is insane for you to chain him up like this. And then they explained to him that I ran away, and I broke the window out and ran away. So the next thing I know, they were shipping me to another county. And they shipped me to a county in New Orleans, to the county jail in New Orleans, because they told me, they said, we got enough for you. So we're gonna send you where the bad boys at.
Wow.
And I stayed there, and then they would bring me back for trial.
Let's take a break. We have a call. Caller, you're on.
Yes, ma'am. How are you doing this evening?
I'm fine. How are you?
Oh, fine. I have a question for you. This friend of mine, he got in trouble back in 79. And he's on probation for five years. And then also he had paid tuition to the victim. It was a sexual assault case, and he was just wondering, is that going to be on for life, or is the record on the police record?
Now, sir, we don't really give legal advice. We try to educate about the system, but let me just tell you this in general. If you're arrested and you do time, it's on your record for the rest of your life, unless you're pardoned by the governor or the president of the United States.
So it's no use getting a loan?
I've answered your question. Your question. Thank you for watching, and please stay on topic. If you call back, please listen to our story and try to comment on our story. Thank you for calling Truth and Justice with Vivian King. Okay, sir, you can continue.
Yeah, and what happened next was when we went to trial, there were it was a lot of people that were there that I had never seen before that were witnesses. And
now, while you're in jail, you have a lawyer. So your lawyer never told you that witnesses were going to come and testify against you?
No, he never told me. He just told me we going to court. You know, and he would be in court with me, and he would say, he said, don't speak until I tell you to.
Did he ever talk to you while you were in jail about what happened?
He asked me questions. And my thing was that I was never going to tell him the truth.
Okay.
Because I didn't trust him.
Okay.
Because I knew he was a state-appointed lawyer. And while I was in jail, you know, inmates talk. And they let you know who's who. You know, who if he's going to railroad you.
Which lawyers are going to railroad you and which lawyers you can trust.
Which lawyers you can trust. And the lawyer that I wanted, they would not give him to my state-appointed lawyer, which was a Christian lawyer that went to the same Catholic church that I was at. That I went to, and they wouldn't give me him. They would not let him, you know. But when we got in court, there were witnesses, and every witness that got up on the stand was white.
Okay.
You know, and so I told the lawyer, I said, well, I don't even know who that person is. Everyone that got up, I said, I don't know that person. Where did y'all get that person? You know, I was sound enough to tell him that, and he said, you just be quiet. You don't say anything. And then the third time we went to trial, he told me, he said, you need to plead guilty.
Now, let me ask you this. When you're saying trial, is there a trial where there are 12 jurors to decide your fate?
Yes.
Or do you mean you're just going to the courtroom?
No, we was going to trial.
So you actually went to trial where you were the person saying, I'm not guilty, and witnesses were testifying against you?
Yeah, at first, that's what we was doing.
So when you went to trial and you said not guilty, did those witnesses say from the witness stand, after raising their right hand, saying, I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, that Mark Simien is the person who killed the dead man? Is that what they were saying?
Well, what they were saying was that I played a part in it, that he was there. He was there.
So they only said you were there. They never said you were the trigger
man. They never said, they didn't know who the trigger man was. They kept saying that we killed the man. They said those three guys killed the man. We know they killed the man.
Well, when you would go to trial, like that first time, were the other two boys there with you in trial?
Yes.
So y'all all sat next to each other with your lawyers?
All sitting there.
So when your witnesses would identify your role, they would say he played a part in it.
Yeah.
But did those witnesses actually see who the young man was that pulled the trigger and shot the man in the head?
No. They didn't know which one of us shot him. They didn't know if he was shot because the bullet went straight through. And they didn't know whether we shot him from the front or he got shot from the back.
So they really didn't see it?
No, they really didn't see it. They didn't really see us with guns at all. You know, they didn't really see us with guns at all. They just were going by what they saw us doing, and that was putting the body in the car.
Right, so they didn't really see the whole story.
They didn't see the whole thing.
Did you testify in any of your trials?
I testified one time, and after that, he told me that I would no longer have to testify.
And what did you tell the truth when you testified?
I did, because I was tired. I was tired, and what I did was that I asked if I could talk to the other two guys, if we could all come together and talk. And at first, they told me no. But when I talked to the sheriff allowed us to come together and talk. And so all of us decided, you know, because they really promised us that we weren't going to get the death sentence. They promised us that.
Even though there was a death penalty case?
Yes. They promised us that we would not get the
death
penalty.
And who was they?
If we plead guilty.
Who was they?
The DA.
So the DA promises you three boys after you've gone to trial once. Was there a hung jury? I mean, what happened?
It was a hung jury three times.
Oh my God!
Three times it was a hung jury.
So
and
y'all
could have
won.
Took so long.
Y'all would have never lost then.
No.
No jury would have ever convicted you because nobody saw who did the shooting.
That's right. But what happened was.
Oh, that's awful.
What we found out later, after we were convicted and after we were sentenced, is that the person that was killed
was a bad guy.
But he was kin to somebody that was in the law enforcement.
But because any guy, white or black, he was a white man, 35, y'all are kids, that came up to you with a sawed-off shotgun and said, give me your money and your drugs, he hadn't done that for the first time either. I mean, he had been a bad dude.
Well, he had a record.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, he had
and
a record.
So did your lawyers, prior to any of your trials, investigate him to say that he had a record?
No,
did that come up in the trial?
None of that came up.
Mm.
None of it came up. They, you know, when we really realized we got railroaded, it was over with. You know, and it
was. So once your lawyer convinced you to plead guilty, then you just had a sentencing hearing.
That's all we had.
And is that when you testified?
That's when all three of us testified.
So when you were having those trials that were hung juries, y'all didn't testify then?
No, we
weren't. Because had you testified then, you probably would have been found not guilty.
Right.
Or it would have been more persuasive because you didn't do any shooting.
Yeah,
and y'all were,
let us.
Even the young man who did the shooting was defending somebody. Even though y'all were doing a crime by selling dope, if someone pulls a gun on you, in every state in the country, you have a right to defend yourself or another person has a right to defend you. So if Tina's pulling a gun on me and you come and shoot her, you're still justified in doing that because you have a right to defend another person. So none of y'all should have gone to prison for that at all. Now, you should have gone to prison for the other crimes that you committed, but you shouldn't have gone to prison for that.
Yeah, and the thing about it is that we had another lawyer that came, and he told us that that you're going to get railroaded.
So someone just anonymously comes and visits you and tell you that?
And he was an evangelist, but he was a lawyer.
Okay.
And he told us, he said, they're gonna make an example out of you three. Say, do you realize what y'all did? Y'all killed a white man. And that's what he told us. And he was a white man that was telling us this. You know, he said, I'm telling you, they're gonna make an example out of y'all.
So you plead guilty, you have a hearing, and then the judge gives you the death penalty.
He gave us the death penalty.
And all three of you?
Yeah.
Wow. So you're 15 in the death penalty, 16 and 17 getting the death penalty.
And they tried to justify by having a juvenile judge in the midst of us. They tried to justify it and charge us as adults.
That's awful.
Very awful.
That is awful.
Well, let me
say this before you say. Let's show some pictures. Mr. Simian was able to produce three pictures, so let's show them. Tell us what we're looking at, Mr. Simian.
This is the front of Louisiana State Penitentiary, Angola, Louisiana.
Were you in Angola?
Yes.
Okay.
On death row in Angola State Penitentiary.
Wow. Let's see the next picture.
This is the electric chair.
So is that the electric chair in Angola that you were supposed to be?
That's the one they retired not too long ago.
But you were supposed to get in that electric chair.
That's the electric chair. That's the death chamber.
And let's see the next one.
And that is me in the black shirt.
With the afro, big afro in the middle.
15 and a half years old.
So that's it. Who's to the right of you?
That's one of the guys, Pastor Dawson.
The one in the blue?
Yes.
The one
that's next to me. That's one of the guys.
And was he the
17.
He's the 17-year-old, so he's the one that did the shooting.
He's the one that shot the guy.
And then who's that over to the
left?
That's
his little sister.
Oh, that's his little sister.
That was the only picture that I had left.
Okay. Thank you for the pictures. Danny, you were going to make a comment.
Well, somewhere in the process, nobody came to you guys, either jailhouse lawyers saying that the worst thing you guys could do was plead guilty if you already had 200 juries. Like ride it out?
Three hung juries.
Nobody suggested to ride it out?
No, because the lawyer that they gave us, they handpicked him.
Right.
And we found that out later, after everything was over with, he was handpicked by somebody. You know, because the blacks in this particular town rallied against it.
Against what?
Against us getting the death penalty.
After the fact?
Yeah. They rallied against it, but it didn't do any good. You know, it didn't do any good because they knew we was railroaded. They knew it.
Well, I mean, it's still good to know that people rallied against it because today things happen and nobody makes a noise, maybe five people. So that was the 70s, the protest 70s.
Yeah.
That was the end of the protest days. So people
rallied against it. I mean, not only blacks, but whites as well. You know, they came together and they rallied against it. I mean, they had our pictures on their shirts and everything.
Wow.
You know, the case brings up so many important legal issues. One, 15, 16-year-olds were still considered children. And there's been lots of research on the brain and the fact that developmentally you're not adults. And the fact that you were going to be executed for something you did as a child, even Amnesty International had lots of research back then about how the U.S. was using execution and the death penalty to execute children when they were under 17 years old. The second issue is the disparate impact that punishment when a victim is white. The criminal justice system is rampant with statistics that you get a higher punishment when the victim is white. And in fact, you got the highest punishment, the death penalty. So your case brings up so many issues besides the legal issues and so on. Very, very sad.
Very, very sad. So what year did you finally get the death penalty?
Yeah, I had just turned 16. It was in December of 75.
So all of this, three trials and the death penalty, all happened in one year.
But yeah, and the thing about it is that it was so rapid that it seemed like every week we was going to trial.
Wow.
And it was at nighttime.
Wow.
It was in the evening time, because I remember that because it was dark outside. You know, and they brought us in like we was already criminals. I mean, they had us shackled down like we was already in prison.
Wow, so you go to prison and you get your death penalty sentence in 75. You've been sober now for a year. How is that affecting you mentally?
Well, mentally, it affected me to the point where I went to the point where the first person that said something to me, I was all over. Because I was afraid that I would lose my life in prison because I was so young. You know, and when I first got to prison, they did an orientation.
So that's in Angola?
In Angola. They do an orientation on you, you know, and they take you through the formation of...
Let me hold that thought for a moment. We're going to start back at Angola at 16. Mm-hmm. We have a phone call. Caller, you're on. Please lower your volume on the TV and just talk in your telephone, and please stay on topic.
Okay. Hello, how you doing, Ms. King?
Hey, how are you?
I'm doing pretty good. I trust you. Your holiday went well and your little vacation. I'm going to see you back, nurse, back to health.
Thank you.
I want to say hello to Danny and Mark and Tina.
Hello.
Okay, well, the question I wanted to ask was, I know you shouldn't have got the death penalty, but wouldn't it have been a crime for, trying to hide the body, dispose of the body?
In some states, it is, but in Texas, it's not. So,
okay. But this happened in Louisiana, right?
Yes, but remember in Texas when the Rockefeller descended in Galveston, cut up the body in all those small pieces. It wasn't a crime to cut up that body and throw it in the river. Mm-hmm. The crime was only to do the murder, and he was successful in proving self-defense is why he killed him. So he was found not guilty because the crime was justified in defending himself, according to the jury. And it didn't matter in Texas about the fact that he cut him up into small pieces and threw his body in the river. In the Galveston, and so in Texas, it's not. I'm not going to even say or speculate what the law is, but generally, that's not the crime. The crime is the murder.
Okay, I thought it had something like what they call it, tampering with a corpse or something like that, mishandling of a corpse.
It could be, but it depends. I mean, remember, everything's about development of the facts, and the focus was not the corpse because the corpse needs to already be dead. Do you understand what I'm saying? And so it's like if our friend's body is in the ground, it's a corpse, and somebody goes and tampers with it, that is a crime because it's at its final resting place. Do you understand? Like in a cemetery. But is it a corpse? I mean, when they put the body in the trunk or dispose of it, the man could have still been alive. Who said he was dead when he got shot? So, I mean, you know, that's not the issue, basically.
Okay.
That's not the issue. Because someone would have to prove that he was dead when the body was moved. And so who would be able to prove that?
Okay, I'm going to get off. I want to hear the rest of the story. So, you know, pretty interesting there. I'm trying to get to the good part.
Thank you. Thank you for your support. Bye. Yes, sir. So now you're 16, and everybody else is probably 17 and 18, yeah. And y'all all went to Angola. Same trip, yeah. Same ride?
On the same bus.
Yeah. Okay, so then...
They were determined to send us to prison.
Okay.
You know, the judge told us that... He was real rude to us. When he sentenced us to death, he called our names and he said, "I sentence you to death in Louisiana's legislature." Mm. You know, because you don't deserve. You are a menace to society.
Mm. You don't deserve to live.
You don't deserve to live.
And y'all were just children. Did you have any support in the courtroom from your family at that time?
No support.
What about the other two boys?
Yeah, they had support because their families, I mean, other two guys' family was, you know, they stayed in nice neighborhoods and, you know, your family had nice jobs. But, you know, my dad and my stepmom, they were real poor. They didn't have all of that. And they weren't about to, you know, it was an embarrassment for them.
Right.
So they didn't show up.
Okay. So tell us about getting to Angola. So did all three of you decide when you're on the bus, hey, we're fighting our way through this. We're not going to let these older men take advantage of us and rape us or
be
their punk.
We talked about that. We talked about that, but they separated each one of us once we got there.
Y'all could have fought together.
Yeah, they separated us, and we ended up in different places. I went to C camp. They went, and then they had two portions that you go to. Camp J was one that they sent us in the beginning. Camp J is where you lock down 24 hours a day, you don't get any recreation or anything.
And y'all little kids. I mean, y'all teenagers,
yeah,
basically.
And they felt like, you know, when I turned 17 is when they actually put me on death row. When I turned 17, the other two guys were on death row when I got there. They automatically put them there. Mm. But when I turned 17 is when they actually put me on death row.
Mm. So everybody in that unit is on death row?
Everybody in that particular unit.
Okay.
And they call it the death chamber.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
In Angola. Wow. So you got there, and
it's six by eight cells.
Wow. Yeah. And as soon as you get there, you're deciding that, hey, I'm fighting my way out of this.
Yeah. I said I wasn't going to die in Angola. That was my whole thing, that I weren't going to die in Angola.
Well, you're going to the death penalty.
Yeah, but
Angola.
I said I would not die.
And if you shoot somebody, or fight somebody and kill them, they're going to kill you there. So how were you not, what was your little mind telling you?
Well, I was ready to commit suicide.
Wow.
But I wasn't going to let them kill me. I was refusing to allow them to kill me in the electric chair.
I got you.
You know, and I did make some attempts.
Oh, wow.
But God didn't allow it to happen.
That's right.
So how'd you try to kill yourself?
I took a whole bunch of pills that somebody else had.
So did they pump your stomach, or you just suffered through it?
Well, the guy next door to me, they called him Doc. And Doc gave me something to drink, and the next thing I know, I was okay. You know, about a day after that, I was okay. You know, I tried. I mean, I swallowed stuff, you know. Different liquids, gasoline. I even swallowed gasoline.
Oh my goodness!
You know, I made many attempts to.
So how did you? I mean, when you went unconscious or something, would you say, "Oh God, I still want to live," and you tell somebody so they'd help you, or how did you?
No, they just passed by to say and see me like that.
See you damn near dead.
Yeah, and take me to the infirmary.
Wow, and I guess that happened to other guys on death row.
Yeah, it did, and they checked on a regular. They walked that tier on a regular to check and see if, you know, because some people hang themselves. You know, some people.
So did you ever try to do that?
No, never. I never could do that.
Well, take a lot of courage.
I couldn't do that.
Right.
Let's take another call. Caller, remember to put your phone. No phone. Okay, no phone. False alarm.
But I learned a lot of things on death row. I read a lot of books.
Now, where would you get the books?
A librarian would come from the other part of the prison and bring books by for us to read. I mean, ask us what type of books we want to read, you know, and majority of the books that I wanted to read were autobiographies of people, and I mean, you know, Malcolm X and, you know, different Martin Luther King. You know, I wanted to read something that would justify, you know, me being the color I am. You know, I didn't want to read anything else. Mm-hmm. But eventually, I started reading my Bible. And when I started reading my Bible, I got so deep into the Word, and then everything that I learned as a child in church started coming back. Mm-hmm. And then the Holy Spirit ministered to me on a daily basis, and the next thing I know, I was on death row. They give you 30 minutes to shower or 30 minutes to walk the yard. It's a little yard, maybe big as this table that you walk in, and they shackle you down when you go in there. But I would take 30 minutes to teach Bible study and 30 minutes to shower. Mm. And I did that every day for years, for years. And what happened, the guards would, two guards that really didn't like me because I was defending everybody that they mistreated. Mm-hmm. Because I would talk crazy to them, and I would tell them, you know, You know, you can't mistreat. We already been mistreated. We already on death row. How bad can it get?
How bad can it get?
I mean, at least give us some type of peace. Sure. But they didn't like me. So what they did is that they decided that they would, you know, get even with me. Mm. And this was after the two guys that went with me were electrocuted.
Oh, they were electrocuted.
And they brought their bodies right by my cell.
So your two friends got electrocuted?
They were electrocuted.
Oh, wow. Yeah. I didn't know that. Oh, my God.
And they brought both of their bodies by me. Right. These same two guards.
What years did they get electrocuted?
They got electrocuted like in 80. It was like 80. Well, no, it was 70. I think it was 78. 78.
Oh, my God. That fast?
3 years?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
And the thing about it is that somebody inside, this particular person that was inside, I think this guy was kin to them that was murdered, and he had some kind of pull.
Right. And that's why everything was railroaded so quickly.
They railroaded, and they wanted to just get rid of us. Right. They wanted to get rid of us. That's what they wanted to do.
But how amazing that they killed them first and they hadn't killed you. I mean, why didn't you get killed right after that? Other than the grace of God, of course. Yeah. But what legal reason was it?
This is what happened. They took me, these three guys, these guards took me and sat me in the electric chair because they was going to teach me a lesson. They told me, since you want to talk up for everybody, you next in line. You know that, right? And so, you know, I mean, you know, I would cry and, you know, they took me there three times and sat me in a lecture and strapped me down and told me I needed to get used to it because I'm next in line. That's after the other two guys were electrocuted.
Oh, my God.
And 30 days before I was to be electrocuted, the same guy called me. He racked my bar back and called me and said I had a letter. I had never received a letter from nobody.
Wow.
Never. And we had, like, little mirrors we looked down the hallway with to see what's going on. And I took my mirror and looked down because I thought they were playing another game. And it was a letter sitting in the bars for me. And when I went down there and I grabbed the letter out the bar and he said some funny remark. And I looked in the left-hand corner and it said United States Supreme Court. And my name was in the middle. And when I opened the letter, stamped in red writing was acquitted of the charges.
Oh, my God.
And I didn't find out till after that some interns,
right,
without me knowing it,
some interns
took my case back to the Supreme Court and tried it and got me acquitted of the charges.
And you never knew that was going on?
I never knew anything about it.
Wow.
I never knew anything about it. And the great thing about it is that, you know, I here I am teaching Bible study, you know, and trying to live for God while I'm on death row. And I was convinced that if I did die,
sure,
I would be with God.
Wonderful.
It was no doubt in my mind.
What a fabulous story.
That's a fabulous story.
Let's cap on that one. That's a fabulous story.
It is.
You know, but.
Wow. And how old were you then?
I was like 18.
So you were 18. So now you've been in custody for 3 years. You're 18. Did you get out that day?
No. It took years before they let me out.
So 10 years later they let you out?
It took a while.
That was
What they did, I stayed on death row for like maybe, it was like, this was almost 15 years after.
So when you got this letter that said acquitted.
I had been on death row for 15 years.
So that was 1990?
Yes.
Right.
Wow.
Yeah, I had been on death
row. So 30 days before you were to be executed. So you weren't going to be executed until 1990?
Yeah.
So why did it take 15 years for you, though, when everybody else got executed in 3 years?
I guess because I was the youngest. I don't know.
And maybe they had been appealing all that
time. Exactly. Yeah. That's exactly right.
Because I had no idea this was going on.
All those writs.
Yeah, I had no idea because I had never tried to appeal my case.
But I wonder why nobody was doing it for the other two. They were underage.
I know.
Louisiana laws and judicial system seems nothing like Texas system, because even back then, it, you know, people stay on death row 20 years, 10 years.
But not those two.
What's Louisiana?
Well, there's corruption in every system.
Well, you know, most of the people
there's
that...
There's probably some corruption going on in that whole process.
Yeah, but I can't see corruption when two people are treated one way and not the other one. I would think it would be all or nothing.
Now, you
that's
know
the part
what?
I'm missing.
But you know what? On death row, a lot of people that's on death row are appealing their case.
Right.
Majority of the people that were on death row when we got there, a lot of them was appealing.
Well, obviously you were too, but you didn't know it.
I didn't even know it.
So I'm just saying everybody, but I'm just saying everybody has appointed somebody to appeal it for them when you're on death row. Most laws, states' laws are like that automatic.
Right.
And so the other two should have been appealing too. So that's what's interesting is that everybody had the same process. They all went to trial together. They all got hung juries together. Mm-hmm. They all pled guilty together. They all got the death penalty together. The only thing different was your age.
And age is a factor.
But the 16-year-old was still been treated the same way.
Should have.
There's no state in the union where 16 is an adult.
Correct.
So the 15 and 16-year-old should have been at least
they should have been
the
treated the same.
Maybe not the 17-year-old.
I agree.
Under Texas law, I don't know what Louisiana law, but the 16-year-old still been a juvenile.
Should have been.
And so, but he said that the same juvenile judge treated them all, you know, saw all of them, even the 17-year-old. Mm-hmm. So I would make a wild guess without researching it. We're going to have Mr. Simien on again when we can actually research the law now that we know his case. And we know that it went to the United States Supreme Court. We can find it. We didn't know that before we started today. But I'm sure that 18 must have been the law for them.
Mm-hmm.
Because otherwise, that juvenile judge wouldn't have been looking at
this
case unless it was some type of general jurisdiction.
Right.
But
I agree.
We'll look that up.
I agree.
Wow, what a blessing. Did you meet the people who did this for you?
Yeah, I did. But, you know, I want to share that when these guys took me down and put me in an electric chair three times and strapped me down, you know, I fell on my knees one day and I asked God, I said, Lord, why would you allow them to do this to me?
Yes.
And I got an answer.
Oh, my goodness.
He told me the first time they did it was for the Father. Second time they did it was for the Son.
Mm.
The third time they did it was for the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
I resurrected you from the lake.
Oh, my God.
That was good.
You know, and the minute I got that confirmation from God, it just did something to me. And from that moment on, I was like, I'm living for you for the rest of my life.
I'm a new man in Christ.
I'm new.
Exactly. Oh, wow.
You know, and yeah, I did get to meet those interns. And they had no idea of a lot of stuff that I had been through.
Sure.
You know,
they never even came and visited.
No.
They just appealed it based on principle.
They didn't even have a picture of me. Nothing.
Wow.
That
were they at a college or university?
They was at some college, and I think it was Southern or Grambling somewhere down there.
Wow.
It was some little small college.
Wow.
Could you imagine seeing this on a movie of the week?
Oh, wow. It's made for movies.
It's
a story made for TV.
And the only other thing I can think about is, you know, writs are very specific as you do them, and I'm just thinking your writs were probably totally focused on age. And that was something the Supreme Court wanted to rule on and took up and did. And I don't know about those other guys' writs.
I also got
they
a
probably
chance.
Didn't go through.
I also got a chance to meet the judge that sentenced me.
Mm. When?
After I got out.
Now, did you have to go before his court to get out, or how did you meet him?
No, I didn't have to go before his court. I mean, what they did.
They just let you out of Angola?
They
walked out of Angola?
They took me to the bus stop, gave me a little money, 50 bucks, took me to the bus stop and dropped me in Louisiana, in Lake Charles.
And where'd you go?
I went to Miami House, the only place I knew to go.
Okay.
Because I didn't know where my mom stayed or none of that. I knew she was in Lake Charles, but I stayed with Miami. You know, but
you already had known your aunt before when you lived with your grandmother?
Yeah, when I went to my auntie's house, she said, you're not going anywhere else. You're going to stay right here.
Had you ever communicated with her those 15 years?
I communicated with her the first few years. And after that, we lost contact. But I got to meet the judge that sentenced me.
And how'd that happen?
I went back to Homer.
Hmm.
Why would you do that?
Well, I have relatives, you know. I mean, I went back to see my stepmom. I went back to see my dad.
Wow.
You know, I went back to see them because the rumor was that I died of AIDS in prison before I got to the lecture.
Oh, okay.
That was the rumor.
So your aunt had said that people thought you died of AIDS.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That was the rumor.
So
they thought I had died of AIDS.
In prison?
Yeah, in prison.
Okay. Mm.
But the great thing about it is that when I got to meet the judge is...
How did you meet him? Did you go to his house or did he call you? I mean, what happened?
No, I went to the courthouse.
Oh, wow.
Because I had to meet him because...
Did you take some backup in case they threw you back in jail?
No, I wanted to see if he remembered me. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, I got a little older, but he did not remember me.
Wow.
But when I said my name, he remembered.
Wow.
Because he knew that you had been acquitted.
Yeah.
Because the judges get the notice. He's still a judge. He was still a judge 15 years later.
He was still a judge.
Yes, Lord.
He was a little older, but he was still a judge, and he was amazed because he said that, you know, you were guilty of that charge. You do know that, right? I say, yeah. I say, but Judge, God has the last word.
And you weren't guilty.
I wasn't really guilty. I mean, when I really look at it and I really think about it, I really wasn't guilty because I was not the trigger man.
You didn't pull the trigger. Yeah. The man came on you. He was jacking y'all. You weren't jacking him.
Right.
I mean, y'all were wrong for selling drugs, but you got jacked and you were there. And even though you disposed of his body, you didn't kill him.
Exactly.
And so, I mean, that's not a crime.
Yeah.
And the guy who killed him was defending someone. So I'm sure he always felt justified in doing that.
Yeah, he did because he felt like he was protecting us.
He was.
His buddies, you know what I mean? We hung together. We did everything together. And he felt like he was protecting us from this guy, you know? Because this guy, I don't think it was the first time he tried stuff like that.
Apparently not.
You know, but he felt like he was protecting us. And we decided that once we got rid of the body, we decided we weren't telling on each other. We were not going to rat each other out.
And you never did.
Never did. But they tried.
Until you had the meeting.
We had the meeting. But they promised us that we wouldn't get.
Nothing in writing. Nothing in writing, just a promise.
No.
Lawyers never put promises in writing.
They didn't even record it. They didn't record nothing that we said.
I'm thinking.
Even though when you testified, they didn't record that?
They didn't record it in the room we was in.
No, I'm just saying when y'all finally testified and told your side of the story during the sentencing phase, was a court reporter taking it down?
We was in a hearing because we were juveniles and they had a juvenile judge and a regular judge.
But there's still usually a little stenographer on the
I didn't see anything like that.
Nobody recorded.
I seen somebody writing some stuff.
It may have been shorthand back then. Yeah,
I seen somebody writing stuff, shorthand. But as far as, you know, like they do now, they record everything that you say and stuff. They weren't doing anything like that.
It was
they have someone taking shorthand either on computer or by hand.
Right.
But they don't always.
And it was a dark room. It was one of those rooms where you can see in from the glass. You can't see out when you're in it.
So that wasn't a courtroom.
No, it was it was a long table. They called it a hearing. They said it was a hearing.
But it wasn't in the courtroom you had the trial in.
No, it was the room that we were going in to confess, to say we was guilty.
So that's like an interrogation room.
Yeah.
Sure. Sounds like.
But was the judge there?
It was a juvenile judge and both of the lawyers were there. It was two lawyers there. It was not a lawyer, but a DA.
Were all three of you represented by the same lawyer?
Yes.
Oh my God. Yeah, lots of corruption.
So that's what I'm saying. That's why it's weird that they still seems like it almost would have been the same team then working on their appeal.
Yeah, correct.
Because it's the same lawyer, you know, usually. So it's going to be because it's the same defense.
Exactly.
Wow. That is definitely movie worthy.
Yeah, I'm still in shock because of the high fast pace. If it was three hung jury, that's 36 different people. Am I right?
And that means there would never have been a meeting of the minds. Even in that corrupt town with them, a small town with three black boys accused of killing a white man, it sounds like the trial was fair. Because it doesn't sound like any of the witnesses lied and said he's the trigger man. They just said they were all in it, you know, but they don't know exactly who did it, but we saw him disposing of the body. It also seems like since the community rallied behind them that they realized there was something wrong.
Sure.
And you can best believe the jurors were all white and somebody knew that the guy who got killed wasn't no good. Somebody knew that. I mean, you know, you were 15, so you don't realize that. But if you're in a small community, somebody knew the deceased.
Oh, yeah.
Somebody knew that he was a bad guy.
Right.
I mean, a lot of people might try to run some little thugs out of town with a gun, but to actually be trying to jack them for their drugs, that means he knew how to dispose of the drugs.
Sure.
So he wasn't doing right, and he couldn't have been doing right the day before. So somebody probably knew that he wasn't right.
Mm-hmm.
And they knew it had to be some foul play.
Exactly.
Now, I've had a lot of my own experiences dealing with crime, but it still, you know, seems surreal what you went through. And it's going to take me a while to process it. And I'm sure our audience is going to take a while to process it. And this is my first time hearing Mark's story. And I met Mark for the first time 2 weeks ago. When I heard Mark say he was on death row, I knew immediately that he would be my next guest. And the funny thing about it is we were looking for someone to start this year out, because this is our first show of the year. And I took their ministry actually runs at 3 p.m. on Sunday, and this is during the playoffs and everything. But for some reason, I felt that if I go to this meeting, that I would have the opportunity to network and meet someone. And that's how I met Mark and his amazing story. And it's encouraging. It gives hope on top of my hope that I already have. But what I really inspired to believe that somebody out there listening is going to believe that someone can go through something, but God can bring them through it.
Amen.
And I mean, it's just been a joy and uplifting experience meeting you.
Let's take a call. Caller, please turn your volume down on the TV and talk directly into your phone. Thank you for calling.
All right. good evening, Ms. King. And I appreciate you allowing me to be on to say this. Mr. Simien, first of all, I understand you're saying you from Lake Charles. Do you know Clifford Simien?
That's my first cousin.
Married to a lady named Willie Mae Simien?
That's my first cousin.
I sure like to meet you in person. And the thing that I want to ask you is this: what was it for you to not hate now, or do you still see situations where someone be accused of something that they really didn't do, and they go to jail and be falsely accused, get life, and then when you see somebody actually kill somebody, like that situation in Florida, and that guy got away free, what does that do to you this day, and how do you handle post-traumatic stress, how you deal with post-traumatic stress?
Mm-hmm. Well, the way I deal with that is I have the love of God. Okay. I pray on a daily basis, and I get up every morning, because every morning I get up, I make the devil out of a lie. And I recognize that it was God that did this, and not me and not man. It was God, because he has a purpose and a plan for my life. And okay. I sympathize with people that have gone through similar to what I've gone through, and people that I've met since I've been doing prison ministry that are not guilty of some of the charges that they're in there for. So I can sympathize with them, and I can, I can mainly witness to them and give them what God gives me so that they can be better at what they do.
Exactly.
Okay, and the last question, how can someone, do you allow others to join your ministry to go out and with you?
Well, that's a great segue. We're going to close up. We have 5 minutes, and he's going to tell you about his ministry, and I don't know if he wants to tell the whole city his phone number, but you can always look at the end of the show in the credits, and you can email me or contact me at my office, 713-222-2019.
I got your number on my phone.
All right, well, just call me, and I'll get you in touch with him if he doesn't give you his number, okay? Thank you for calling, and God bless you.
All right.
Let's close up by everyone's going to take 2 minutes, but let me start with, we'll end with you since you're the great guest. You gave yours. Let me let Tina say something, Danny.
Mr. Simien, I think your story is an amazing one. It's a story whereby we see the corruption in the criminal justice system and how it can continue, and how we all as citizens have to be mindful of what's going on, mindful of the process, mindful that there are checks and balances. The prosecution is a check and it's supposed to be a balance. The judge is a check, it's supposed to be a balance. And we all need to be involved. It's sad that judge stayed on the bench as long as he did, because there was an injustice done. And it's sad that he still felt that you were guilty after a U.S. Supreme Court reversed it. And so we all, as citizens, have a part to play. We have to vote, and we have to recognize when these situations occur. And we thank you for being here and giving us your story, and hope that inspires people to be involved, to vote, to know who's in your criminal justice system, to make sure that the people in the system are there, they're fair, and won't allow something like this happen to you.
And we have 3 minutes. So, Mr. Simien, we want you to take all of that time and promise me before you end that you will be my guest again.
I promise.
Okay. Tell us what you're doing in life and how people can get involved in your ministry.
Well, I'm originally at the Little Grove Missionary Baptist Church, where I'm over the prison ministry there. I've been doing prison ministry now for approximately 20-something years. I mean, I started out at another church, but I've been doing prison ministry quite a while. We've just recently started a ministry called Ex-Con to Icon, where we help ex-cons get jobs. We tap them into the sources that we have, but we also help them become entrepreneurs, because most of them are coming out with skills. They have welding skills, they have writing skills, whatever type of skills they have, we try to tap them into that particular skill so that they won't have to work for nobody, work for themselves. You know, help them to get a business loan, a small business loan. But mostly what I enjoy doing most is doing prison ministry. And that...
Do you actually go into the prisons?
I go into the prisons. Mm. And I witness, I preach. I mean, we go into juvenile homes, get in state school for boys. I went in Crockett State School for 15 years before it closed.
Right.
But I try to be a part of TYC. Anything that has anything to do with prison or anything has to do with adolescents, I want to be a part of it, because I feel as though I can play a major role.
Yes.
You know, and I want to give God everything that I have when it comes to people being incarcerated, people that, you know, I mean, we also have a mentoring program at the church where we mentor young kids that in single parent homes. And a lot of those kids that we mentor are kids that have, you know, that are rebellious and, you know, doing stuff in school, smoking weed or different stuff. And we try to, you know, let them know our stories and, you know, that it took what we went through, and that what we went through it for them, that they don't have to go through it. You know, and I tell people, I thank God for 15 years of Angola State Penitentiary.
Oh, wow.
Because what it did for me is that it made me into the man that I am today.
Well, we have to wrap it up with that. Thank you so much for watching Truth and Justice with Vivian King. Please pray for Mr. Simien and Mr. Sneed and all of us, that we can stay on the right track and that we can keep encouraging you and educating you about the criminal justice system here in Harris County and around the United States, obviously, because we're in Louisiana today. But anyway, thank you for watching, and please tell your friends, and let's watch again next Wednesday when we bring you another exciting story at 6:30 p.m. Thank you.
Tonight we have something really good, hot topic in the news this week.
He's been charged with crime.
This is a show where I try to...